Rivers from Bartus Labs in New York City, and I am very pleased to announce that our first presenter is Patrick Whaley. Patrick Whaley graduated from the Georgia Institute of Technology with a mechanical engineering degree. He is the founder and CEO of TITIN. From an AATCC perspective, we're very happy to have him here. He is the recipient of the AATCC Young Entrepreneurs Award. He also happens to be an Eagle Scout, which I found really fascinating. And from a business perspective, he's been on ABC Shark Tank, mentioned as the next big thing on CNN, and is the winner of the Under Armour Innovation Challenge. The title of Patrick's presentation is Tragedy to Triumph, so please join me in welcoming Patrick.
Thank you so much. It is an absolute pleasure to be here, and I just want to thank each and every one of you for waking up this early and still coming to the presentation. I want to start off with a question. Who in here had a dream? When they were a kid, they were in elementary school, they were in middle school, who had a dream to be an astronaut or anything that was so aspirational people told you you were impossible? Everybody raise your hand if you had a dream that really drove you, that you were passionate about. Now keep your hands up if somebody actually told you that you were crazy. Most of us in here. I want to start off with that because I believe that it's very important to understand what you're passionate about. Because in this world, in this lifetime, you live once. And if you do not follow your own passion, then you're following someone else's. When I started Titan, I had numerous people tell me that it couldn't be done. I even had a patent attorney at the time that I no longer work with, but I had a patent attorney at the time that told me, don't even bother filing for a patent because you'll never get it. And now I have 25 patents, both domestically and internationally, just to say that if you truly believe in yourself, if you believe in a passion and a reason, anything is possible. Titan is the world's only weighted compression gear. It is a shirt that embodies the human anatomy. Everything we do is designed around the human body, so when you put it on, it feels like it's a part of you. It feels like it's your own muscle. You can also heat it or freeze it. So in addition to weighted training, you can also use it for recovery as a mobile ice bath or heating pad. When you are developing something that has never been done before, you will be met with adversity. Or not. It will happen. But it's up to you and everybody in here to look at that adversity and say, I believe in it so much that I know I will overcome. The problem statement was pretty simple. Current items on the market are bulky, they're cumbersome, there's very few things out there that allow athletes, that allow weekend warriors, to allow stay-at-home moms to amplify how they train without compromising form. You know, there's always that sense of compromise in terms of you have to have a give and take. And when it comes to fitness, that should not be the case. Take a step back. When it comes to life, compromise should not be the case. I mean, who in here wants to say, you know what, my life is good enough. It's good enough. Nobody wants that. People want to be so inspired that when they wake up, they can say, I love what I do. And I leave an impact on this world because of who I am. And we all have that in us. We all have strengths and weaknesses. And we all have a purpose. And with Titan, I felt that that was my purpose. I had so many ideas when I was younger. I was always developing things. And I had, you guys are going to laugh at this. I had this idea for a jet engine that ran off of alpha-seltzer powder and water. when we were going through a fuel crisis when I was younger. And obviously that was ill-advised. I didn't go anywhere with it. But I did develop a piston engine using those film canisters. That was back before digital film. And that was a lot of fun. But I had all these ideas growing up. And the one thing I got met with was, if it was easy, then everybody would do it. So I kind of just put it on the back burner and I focused on my life. I want to get back to what TITIN is today, and then I'll kind of go through some more history. But what TITIN is today is a company that challenges the status quo. Every day I wake up and every day my team wakes up, we say, whatever it is today is not good enough. Where are we going to be in 5 years, in 10 years? And what is that going to look like? But more so, how does that make us feel? Imagine if everything we did was able to interact with us as if it was just an extension of us, an extension of our own life. And that's what we try to focus on at TITIN. We have athletes ranging from Manchester United all the way to some Bundesliga soccer teams. We were used by the Netherlands Olympic speed skating team, who won 24 medals at Sochi and loved our product so much they gave us a $50,000 YouTube video for us to use, which is pretty great. We have athletes from the Pittsburgh Steelers who call us their secret weapon. Now, the secret weapon, that's an interesting point. We are called the secret weapon for a reason. When you get to that level and you're a professional athlete, you want to have something that puts you in front of everybody else, that allows you to have that edge. And when you find that, it becomes your secret sauce. In branding and in marketing, this is probably the best and worst curse you will ever face, because you have a product and a brand that means something, but who's going to find out about it? And that is something that we continually strive to overcome. We have athlete after athlete that finds out about it. We have weekend warriors that continue to spread the word through CrossFit, through local kickball training and co-ed sports, all the way into our military. Special Forces, Green Berets, Navy SEALs, they will all tell you that our product fits them as if it's an extension of their body. They can do close quarter combat, they can do all their PT training, and then they can even go back and walk around base and get hypergravity training 24 hours a day. The biggest focus I wanted to work on, right? You all have to have one focus when you try to build something, you try to make a difference. And the biggest thing I wanted to focus on was making sure that when somebody interacted with my brand, interacted with my product, that they felt as though it was just designed around their body. It was something that they believed in, but more so, it was something that they could get behind. It was a movement, because people get behind movements. They get behind things that allow them to feel like they're a part of something bigger than themselves. And from a young age, I've always had that. I've always wanted to be something that could inspire somebody, but more so, I wanted to be influential and allow people to feel better about themselves. Again, with what we are, we focus on the ability to merge different industries. We merge the cooling and hydrotherapy with the weighted vest industry, in addition with compression gear. And when you do something like that, it's very hard for people to understand. I remember the first time I tried to sell one of my prototypes, I walked into a fitness studio and I was selling it to his son. The son loved it so much, ran to his mom and said, "Mom, I gotta get one of these." And the first question that his mom asked was, "Oh, that's great, but how do you wash it?" And I'm standing there just speechless. I had no idea. I never even got that far. I mean, I was told from so many seamstresses that it could never be made. I ended up taking my own laptop and using my grandmother's sewing machine watching a YouTube video and trying to make my first prototype. I mean, this thing was hideous. I didn't even want to have pictures of it, right? But that was the first time when I realized that it does solve a problem, but then what's next? What's next? What's after that? How do you use it? Oh, wow, didn't even think of that, right? But that's what happens when you're on the cutting edge. When you're on the cutting edge, it's something that's hard to explain, but you're so passionate about it that you know that you want to move that direction. Other people are going to tell you that you're crazy. They're going to say, I just don't understand. But as soon as you get that prototype, as soon as you have that sample, it will start to come to realization for those around you. We have different markets and different verticals. I started in the fitness industry because that was something that was touching home for me. I was always fascinated with fitness. I was the skinny kid in school that was always wanting to be bigger. I would overstuff my book bag with books and do shoulder shrugs on the way to class when I bulked my shoulders like Rocky Balboa. And I realized very quickly that all that does is cause poor posture and a sore back. So I'd get into my classroom and I would be extremely exhausted, and then I would go into bicep curls with my backpack. I mean, I was that kid that was always striving for something different. And what I wanted after that was I realized that, look, if it's just going to cause a bad back and it's going to make me ruin my posture, why not have something that we can all wear? Something that I could wear like this and nobody would even know I'm wearing it. So my next concept was using a lead-based thread. But the problem with lead is it's poisonous, so I can't be killing off all my customers, which is a very bad business model. And I kept on innovating through middle school, through high school, finally got to college, in Georgia Tech. And in my dorm room, I decided that I wanted to leave an impact. I wanted to design something that people could use every day. No matter what it was, whether they were going for Olympic training or whether they just wanted to lose a few extra pounds. I wanted something that was so versatile that people were able to change their mindset of fitness. And I think that's something that can inspire us all, and that is our movement at TITIN. Change the way people view fitness. No longer does it have to be something as barbaric and cumbersome. It can be something that's designed around your own body. Take ergonomics to a whole new level. We also have the military. The military use our product extensively because it doesn't shift the side around. It feels like their own muscle. We have the weight loss side. We have rehabilitation that I'll get into in a little bit. I actually used it myself after I was shot in the chest in an armed robbery. And I almost lost my life. And then we were also recently awarded for my design on tight tights from Culture City. Culture City is an autism awareness charity. It was ranked as one of the top 10 best charities by Microsoft last year, and they're taking the world by storm. And they saw my invention of Titan Tights from a local child, and the impact that he had was twofold. He had the ability to calm down his symptoms with deep pressure therapy, but then he also felt like his favorite superhero. Rather than feeling alienated, he was able to feel like he could be anybody he wanted. He was idolized. People wanted to be like him. And from a young age, I know what that feels like. I was dyslexic, and I wanted to just feel normal. I wanted to feel as though I was just like everybody else. I didn't really know much about dyslexia. My dad was dyslexic, but it's really taken a long time for us to understand what that truly means. And it wasn't really until I got to college when I understood that it's just how my mind thinks. It's different. It's not wrong, it's different. And if we can use our strengths and our weaknesses to our advantage, that's when we can make a change. I made a Rocky comment earlier, and I think that he's got a lot of great quotes. But one of which that I loved was in one of his more recent movies. He said, "It's not how hard you can get hit. It's how hard you can." I'm sorry. Let me rephrase. because I got to do this right, Rocky Balboa, right? It's not how hard you can hit. It's how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. It's how much you can take and keep moving forward, because that's how winning is done. And I think that at the end of the day, we all have that, right? We all get hit from all different angles, whether it's family, whether it's friends, whether it's coworkers, or whether it's those people that you just meet on the street that are, you know, gonna kick you when you're down. That's what we face every day. Every day we face that. But it's up to us to overcome. It's up to us to look at that and say, I'm gonna take this in stride. And I want to make a difference. I saw this during one of my other speeches, and I just wanted to show you guys what it feels like. It's kind of an estimation, but that's typically how dyslexia appears from the mindset of the individual. So when you start talking about learning disabilities, or when you start talking about disabilities in general, it's not a disability. It's almost like you need to overcome and just start from ground zero. So rather than viewing yourself as disabled, you just have to learn to adapt. And that's what I had to focus on. I focused on trying to make sure that no matter where I was, I could adapt to that situation. And on May 4th of 2009, I was actually a victim of an armed robbery and shot in the chest. I was left for dead in a parking garage. I was approached by three armed gunmen that wanted my wallet and cell phone. Three kids just wanted a few bucks and a cell phone. When you go through something like that, you almost look at everything else that's going on in your life, and it just doesn't mean anything. It doesn't matter because you're still alive. That's what each of us has. We all have that ability, and we all have that opportunity to leave an impact, because this life is our last. And it's up to each and every one of us to change the world one person at a time. So I took that, and I took it in stride, and I used that as leverage. I wanted to strive for something great. So what I did was I went back home and I started trying to get back into fitness. Before I was shot, I was a semi-pro bodybuilder. 6'4", 220 pounds. I walked out of the hospital less than 180 pounds and barely able to stand up straight. I couldn't lift my arm past parallel because I had so much scar tissue. I had a third of my right lung removed, and I had a 70% blood transfusion. I could have taken that. I could have just sat on the couch and said, you know what, at least I'm alive. I'm just going to sit here. I'm good. But that wasn't good enough. That wasn't good enough for me. And I know that that's not good enough for any of you. Otherwise, nobody would have woken up at 9 a.m. to come to the speech. But I took that stride, and I wanted to make sure that I left an impact. And I wanted to take every ounce of energy I had and put it into something that I believed in. I love quotes. And one of the other things I noticed was that in life, other people are going to tell you why something cannot be done. If they can't do it themselves, they just want to tell you why you can't do it. But if you want something bad enough, you have to go out there and get it. Period. Bar none. Because if it means that much to you, you will achieve it. You will achieve it. There are going to be those that want to be naysayers or ride on your coattails. There's going to be those that are going to tell you that you're never going to amount to anything, But that happens, right? There's an 80-20 rule. 80% of all of that stuff, every interaction you ever make, somebody's going to tell you why it cannot be done. And that should be the challenge. That should be our fuel. That should be something that we can just look at them with a grin and say, you know what? You can think that, but I want to keep on going. Don't let people bring you down. You know, this is the Young Entrepreneur Award, and I've been thinking about that a lot. And I wanted to take a look at the word young and youth. And to me, I believe that youth can be a strength and or a weakness, but it depends on the individual and how you use it. You know, there's a great picture right here. It looks like the kid has no idea what he's doing. But he's going to do it anyways, right? It's like pushing that big red button, and I'm going to go for it. We all have that inside us, no matter how old we are, no matter how old we get. You're always going to have that sense of youth. You're always going to want to ask the question, why? And that's where innovation comes from. When you ask the question, why, to something that is just the status quo, and you get the answer, oh, that's because we've done it that way for 50 years. Everybody's shaking their head. I mean, this is something that we've all heard of, right? Oh, we've done it that way for 50 years. Why? We have Facebook. We have social media. You know, there's another story I want to tell you. I started my business in my dorm room, and I was growing, and I kept trying to find investors, and I was winning innovation challenges and business plan competitions, and I was getting to a point where every investor told me that you would be lucky to grow your business 50% in a 12-month period. You would be lucky to be able to at least get a few people to buy your product. And I got so tired of that I realized, you know what, I'm just going to do this on my own. So I leveraged everything I had, from credit cards to you name every asset I owned, and I went into marketing mode, period. And I leveraged Facebook and Google Analytics, growing my business from $10,000 in monthly revenue to $1 million a month in 180 days. When somebody tells you that's the way that we've been doing it for 50 years, they're already a dinosaur. We can either choose to take that information and say, okay, you know what, well, I'm not going to help you, or I'm not going to help myself, or whatever the situation may be. Or we can change our look. We can change our perspective. And that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to show people that it was possible. I grew 100-fold in 6 months when people told me I couldn't grow 50% in 12. I sold out of inventory. I sold out of everything I had. I had a $2 million contract with an Amazon buyer, and I could only deliver on the first shipment. And I went on Shark Tank. And at that point, I realized that it is up to each of us. It is up to each and every one of us to make a change, because people will always commit to something and fail, or they'll commit to something and underachieve. But if you have that passion, you will have that sense and the ability and the energy to be able to overcome that. I asked the question earlier, how many of us have had a dream? And everybody had a dream when they were younger. Whether it was being an astronaut, whether it was being a veterinarian, a doctor, a lawyer, whether it was being, you know, a genius at the Apple bar, right? The Apple TV genius. At the end of the day, we've all had a dream. And some of us had made sacrifices along that way. But we can choose. We can choose to go after that dream. So I want to leave you with this. I love this. I want to leave you with this. If you have a dream, if you have a passion, it is up to you to stand up for what you believe in. It is up to each and every one of us to leave this world better than we found it. And I never want you to stop asking the question, why? Help others and you will succeed. Help others achieve success and you will be successful. Never stop believing in yourself. Thank you so much for your time.